everybody look at you different when they know you've been incarcerated. Everybody look at you different. They don't even know what you, even if you don't gotta be, you don't gotta be found guilty or not guilty just because they know you was incarcerated, you get looked at different.
I feel as though like I'm being segregated, you know what I'm saying, as far as color or whatever like that, and put in the box in the area that I'm playing to fail. You know what I'm saying? Ain't no win.
I grew up in Philadelphia. Philadelphia is, you know, it's not a soft city, you know what I mean? It's definitely has a lot of a criminal element into it, and it has like poor sections. And I mean, that's basically what it comes down to, is low economic background, low education. When I heard them, their stories, when I heard them spitting, you know, I immediately wanted them to be involved on the project, because what they were saying, it seemed like these were the people that we were trying to save, basically, you know what I'm saying? And these are the people who have the real story. These are the people on the front lines that are fighting this war that is basically being raised against them, the war on drugs, you know what I'm saying? Like I say on the record, the war on drugs is not a war on drugs, it's a war on thugs.
Government name?
My name is Prada Otta, also known as Otta Beezy, coming out of South Philadelphia. Possession of a firearm and possession of crack cocaine base. I was in and out since a juvenile. The longest I have done was 8 years incarceration in federal.
Okay, Dr. Showstopper, South Philadelphia. Convicted 3 times, aggravated assault and possession of cocaine. I've been in and out of jail all my life.
My name is Latif, I'm from South Philadelphia. I mean, I've been arrested for possession of a firearm, narcotics.
Yo, what up? It's Mars Co-op from Uptown Logan Valley, East Side, Philadelphia.
DNA, that nigga ain't. Tally up, boys. North Philly, born and raised. Yeah. Every single one of them.
Nah. I'm not guilty.
I was found guilty by a jury, possession of the cocaine, but, the firearm was dismissed. I was found not guilty of that.
I think a lot of my crimes were committed out of the hostility and anger of what I was going through at home. Because when I would get in the streets, me and my guys is, you know, robbing people.
Do you see through the looking glass falling?
When I was 12, that's when I first ran away from home. So I kind of pretty much wanted to, you know, be on my own. You know, I had things going on at home I didn't like, so I would, you know, resort to the streets.
So I feel it was hard, like, we were fucked up, like, seriously. No jobs, you know what I'm saying? People, moms and stuff on crack, you know what I'm saying? Fatherless homes, you know. Just the whole environment was just messed up. I mean, it wasn't, you ain't see no daylight, you ain't even think about nothing positive growing up, because you surrounded by so much negativity that this seemed like this the way. You know what I'm saying? Like this the culture. This is what you gotta do. You gotta sell drugs, carry a gun. You know what I'm saying? Or you playing basketball. I ain't play basketball.
Everybody in my house used the drugs. I'm talking about from my mom, my dad, my aunt, to my grandmother. Everybody. So it was like I seen drugs at a young age, like around the age of 6 years old. I would see like little baggies on the floor. I always wonder what it was. And until I seen people selling it to other people and getting that fast money, that's how I found out. I think it made me strong. I think that me just growing up and seeing all that, it made me stronger, because I know I didn't want to live that lifestyle. I know I didn't want to go in that direction that my family went to. I mean, using drugs every day, abusing their body. But it made me stronger, as though I don't want to live that life, but I like that money. And I know that life, selling that drug and give me that money, or me using drugs, put a downfall, because I know what it did to my family. It was just crazy.
Fortunately, I didn't grow up like most kids. Like most kids, they had to grow up with missed meals, they didn't have clothes. I had all that, I just didn't have parenting. So when you don't got parenting, you got all this stuff, you tend to run wild. You need a father to pull your coat. You need a mother to pull your coat. You know what I'm saying? You need that coming up. I had nobody to do homework with me. Not to sit there and do it with me. My mother didn't have the patience, you know, for that type of stuff.
I got bullied a lot. I'm an only child. I got bullied a lot. And once I came, when I moved up Estill Lane, then I came back down. And once I came to the realization that bumps, bruises, and scars heal the fuck up, it was curtains for anybody to try to do anything. I, you know, master your pain threshold. You start to assess people's weaknesses physically and mentally, and you respond to them accordingly. And a lot of people wouldn't go to the length of to do things to people that I would. So I find myself doing things for people, or just doing things for the sport. I didn't do it out of necessity. I did it just because I could, and it was fun to me for a while. To see people that I thought wasn't shit beg and cry and shit like that, and like to bring that shit out of them.
I think it's Tuesday and Thursday is like the main days where they do street corner sweeps. Like if you want a corner, like in a, like a drug populated area, like you just get and grabbed and like frisk, like stopped and frisked, like basically violating your total like constitutional rights, yeah.
State and local law enforcement agencies are rewarded in cash by the millions for the sheer numbers of people swept in to the system for drug offenses. This helps to explain why law enforcement so often goes out looking for the so-called low-hanging fruit. Stopping, frisking, searching as many people as possible, pulling as many vehicles as possible over in a search for drugs. But of course, they don't do that so much in middle-class white neighborhoods. They don't sweep college campuses and universities for drugs, though plenty can be found there, I can assure you. No. These tactics are applied only in poor communities of color, because that's where they can get away with it and still get paid.
I got arrested. It was a stop, a jump out, as they call it, you know, every Tuesday, Thursday. Cops jump out on people, you know. I'm walking down my block or whatever. Was stopped, frisked, illegally. They had no probable cause to stop me, none of that. But, you know, I had the firearm on me, so I still was convicted, even though it was an illegal search and seizure. You know what I'm saying? So I got arrested, I got charged, and I got found guilty.
My first experience of getting locked up was being in a stolen car with my homie. He was driving, and we got caught.
There was another guy that was arrested, and like they basically like just ran down on all of us. And I was grabbed, and when I was grabbed, they say allegedly I had a firearm and some drugs on me, so they grabbed me too along with the other guy. So that's basically how I got arrested, like basically like in the neighborhood, like when they just did a, like a sweep.
It's hard, so nobody got jobs, none of that. So I chose to sell drugs. And so when I got locked up, which is crazy, like they locked me up back to back. I got locked up, came home, I tried to do it again, got locked up again. Same spot, same time, same area. It's crazy.
It can either reform you or it can make you worse. And with us, it usually makes us fucking worse because we use like, we get out like, fuck y'all, I'ma show y'all now. Y'all put me in there all that time. I missed out on my kids growing up. I ain't never seen him crawl before. Knowing like if I was out there, I wouldn't never even been around that motherfucker anyway.
My worst experience in jail was being locked down the hole for 30 days. I was in a crazy fight, locked me up in a hole. Well, basically, let me break down to the hole. The hole is, it's a cell where it's so small. I'm talking about like the size of your bathroom. You can't even think straight. You'll start to lose your mind if you're in there because it's just, you're not doing that. You do the same stuff every day. You don't come out your cell. You only get a shower every 3 days. You eat any small meals. You don't talk to your family. It's stressful, basically. It's real stressful. And I wish them not my worst enemy. The whole because, and they think that's going, it changed you, but it just make you worse because it messes you up mentally. So I think that was the worst experience I ever had when I was incarcerated.
It's all the stuff that you should have been thinking about out there. You think about it when you in that fucking box, when you doing 23 or 1, and you in there with a nigga that stink, they keep asking you for soups and shit. You wake up and you see one of your they call them smoker cakes, little W's and shit. You see like two of your joints missing, you don't want to beat him the fuck up, and you said like, you know what? Oh fuck it, I'm going to the hole.
Going to the hole, no commissary, You know what I'm saying? Taking a shower every 2-3 days. In solitary confinement, 23-1. You know, being stripped down, you know what I'm saying, to your nudity. You know, that's embarrassing. Nobody wants to go through that. So, you know, that was the worst experience of it all. And not being able to see my kids, you know, family.
I actually told my mom, this is what I told her. I said, Mom, I feel ashamed to be black in here. Because when you go in there, the Puerto Ricans, they stick together. The Asians, they be like, oh, you know, they minority and motherfuckers. They stick together. The whites, they stick together. The Puerto Ricans, they don't even have to know you. You got the Hibados, those the Hicks, the ones that don't speak. They got thick ass accent or they can't talk at all. And you got the regular Puerto Ricans, the ones that hang with us and shit. Now, I mean, you can't even, if you talk to them on the phone, they hardly even know, you know, Puerto Rican or Spanish, none of that shit. They don't even have to know each other. But if a motherfucker come on the block, this nigga could just come in with what just he had, one pair of drawers. By the end of that day, he'll have 7 pairs of drawers. He'll have suits for the whole fucking week. He'll have everything he need, and they stick together. And if you fuck with him, you best believe everybody from that cell down there that don't even know that nigga name will fuck you up. If you go in his cell, take some of his shit. But us, nah. No, you best believe if you go to lunch or you go to sick call or something like that, it's gonna be 5-6 other motherfuckers that look just like me in my cell taking my shit. And if I come back, and they there, those 5 motherfuckers and 13 other motherfuckers just like them gonna dip on my ass. As soon as you get out there and you get that breeze hit you in your face, boom, you see people walking with new clothes on, you got that same old shit you got locked up in, fuck that, I'm gonna do a lesser evil. Try to get some positive out of that shit. That's what we do. What can I do wrong? What can I do fast that can get me some longevity? And none of that shit adds up to no longevity at all. None of it.
That's the reason why they put you in so-called halfway house. You're halfway on the street, halfway still incarcerated, so you can try to adapt to the society. Like, things is like, just being inside of a building for all so many years, and then come home, traffic moving so fast, you know, your house look like a closet, your steps making a lot of noise from the wood. You just normally steal steps in the prison. So you come home and walk on the wooden steps. Everything's loud. You're loud. You're constantly in the bathroom because the cell you in is just a sink or taller than the bed. So you constantly in that small space. It's like you go through some kind of institutionalization.
Philly is not like a big place for, you know, job hiring and all that. You know what I mean? I'm fortunate enough to have a entrepreneur mind state, which kind of kept me above water for a very long time.
Once they see that I'm a felon and I've been incarcerated, it's like when you go fill out an application, everything good. They like everything. Like, they show that you're a good worker, you have experience, until they see that felon. They want to really know like why you're a felon. But it's crazy because just because you're a felon don't mean you're not a good worker or you're not a good person. They always think you're a felon, you're a bad person. They always look at the bad stuff. He's been incarcerated.
Things ain't really changed. You know what I'm saying? When I was locked up or whatever, it was still the same thing. I'm going back to what I know. It's the same environment, same habitat. You know what I'm saying? So ain't too much change. Only thing changed for me was I know I can't carry a firearm no more legally or illegally. I'm gonna get more time. Can't sell drugs anymore, I'm gonna get more time. Now I'm trying to, you know, find a different lane, which is hip hop and music.
Yeah, the open road to American Pie's a dead end, but still the direction that we all headed. Speeding, yeah, nigga can't get no headwind. Going so fast, it's gonna make a nigga head spin. The dragon which consumes its own talent. You've been in full interrogated, your life on the line because you cooperated, incarcerated. No population, isolation. Shout out to Mumia, I see you just have patience. The police patrolling, your ass on the run. You're hooping, you're blackballed, entrapment, you're done. But this the life I chose. I do it for the family, can't forget the bros. Can't forget about them days cold, them days in that hole. Eating them county trees, drinking Bernards out of bowl.
If it wasn't for music, who knows where my life would have turned out, you know what I'm saying? So.
Yes, I see where. And the way is, me as an artist, that's the way out. But I gotta continue and stay on my good deeds instead of going back to that bad vibe, what I was telling you about.
That's my, you know, my sanity. The writing, you know what I'm saying, the music.
That's why, to keep me out of that, I stay in the studio, I stay making music, and I stay with my family. And that's the only way I think that's gonna get me out. so far, hopefully.
God just put enough things in my way, like he stopped moving things out of my way for me to see it. And I've been shot too many times, I've been stabbed too many times. I've been everything under the sun, like seriously. I've been in too many situations where I shouldn't be breathing. I'm actually grateful for the air I'm taking in my lungs. Now I know what it is to be grateful and to have love and self-love. You don't explain it with words, you show that shit.
Stay out of jail. That's all I like to say. Everything you wanna do it positive and do it the right way. Don't make no bad decisions because that's what they're looking for. They wait for you to mess up. The pitch went in and set you as a number. When you go to jail, you're not a name no more. You're nothing but a number. That's real stuff. That's real talk.
After all the shit I've done to people, like, my purpose in life is just to help. Like, I only feel obligated to help and I get closer to God by doing that. That's the only reason I'm living. That's the only reason I want to live.
I think that, like, if you have some kind of craft that's going on with you, you have a, you know, anything that you got going on that you're good in, stick to it and don't, like, revert to the streets because it's nothing there. There's nothing there but incarceration or a tombstone for you. There's nothing there for you. You know, either somebody gonna kill you on the streets or you're gonna get harassed by these police and you're gonna get sent up with 1,000 years for a petty crime. And it's nothing good. There's nothing good out there for you.
Just fight and stay focused. Don't let nothing bring you down. Don't fall into the trap. And just be smart about everything that you wanna do. You know what I'm saying? Do something positive in life. Don't fall into the trap. Don't pick up the gun, sell drugs, you know. I mean, just do something positive with your life.
We are not products of our environment. Nobody's a total product of their environment. No one is. Can't make excuses. Just circumstances, situations, none of that shit's your past. None of that shit should depict your future. If you think positively, every day you're fortunate enough to open up your eyes, I mean, consistently, you can't just stop when shit get hard. You can't just stop and go back, all right, I'm gonna do this, because it's just gonna make it worse. And it's gonna feel worse because you know now. You know, when you're not oblivious to it, it hurts worse every single time. So it has to be a sense of urgency. You gotta believe that your life will end the next fucked up decision you make. They say you're not promised tomorrow. Shit, you're not promised 5 minutes from now. You have a choice no matter what. There's resources out here for all of us. You just gotta look for that shit.
Because we doing this, is stuff gonna change? Is this message gonna make, like, people look at it, stop looking at us differently? Stop looking at us as bad people and just could be incarcerated, we can't have a job, or we just struggling? I just hope it put a message out, it reach out to everybody.
Millions of people are now saddled with criminal records and legally denied the very rights supposedly won in the civil rights movement.
The new Jim Crow, you know, music inspired by Michelle Alexander's book.